IVM.
Hello and welcome to the Habit Coach Podcast. I am Ashton Doctor, your habit coach, and today we're going to be discussing all things running. You know, running has become such a buzzword, especially in the whole fitness world in the last few years, because there were these running movements and marathons. And today we have one of the best possible guests to discuss running with us. You know her as Fit Girl India. We know her as Aisha Bilimoria. So Aisha, welcome to the Habit Coach Podcast.
Hi, Ashton. Thank you so much for having me.
I am so excited to do this because I hate running, right? So for me, it is the exact opposite. So I'm like, how are we going to discuss running today? And you know, how did your passion come into being for running? Like, why running?
Running happened by chance for me. It wasn't something that was planned. I always wanted to be a dancer. But going to a boarding school at the age of 9, I was in a boarding school in Ooty, kind of just made me more involved in sports. I wasn't a very bright kid in the education space. So whenever I had an opportunity to get out of the classroom and be on the field, be it badminton or football, or just run up the slope to go to the football field, I would do that. So I got very athletically, oh my God.
Inclined.
I just came back to Bombay, as in I had to move schools for some personal reasons. So I came back to Bombay and I had to take a midterm admission in Activity High School. And it was pretty much like a family school for us, you know. So Mrs. Bugley was very kind to give me admission in the third term of when the school was almost coming to an end. And luckily, I just entered school 2 days before the sports day. And it was the finals because the heats had already happened. So they said, would you like to participate in the sports day? I said, yeah. So we put in my entry, 100 meters, 50 meters, long jump. At that time, it was just, you know, I was under 12. So yeah, we had these very simple races. And Dad said, whatever happens, just come first. Yeah. Run fast and come first. That's all I want. I said, okay, I'll come first. That's it. I came first. And I came first with a margin. I came first with a really big margin where I had to, actually in the middle of the race, I had to stop and look back and see where the others were because I was a mile ahead. And my whole Nehru house was cheering, finish the race. My father screaming from the stand, finish the race. And he's angry. So I was like, oh God, what did I do wrong? Anyway, that's a very, you know, my races are, I have a very sharp memory of my athletic career because around that time there was no mobile phone. There was no obsession of cameras that we had to click photos or whatever. It was just so pure. It was so passionate. There was so much joy in running that those memories will probably never fade. And I think it's those memories that keep reminding me why I started running in the first place. I started running because I loved the joy of winning. I was aggressive. I was a aggressive racer. You know, I did not like losing. Over a period of time, especially in the initial years, I got so used to winning that suddenly when I started losing because of bad training, bad coaching, injuries, I kind of then got comfortable losing. You know, because also there were several factors that made me comfortable in that losing space. But when I realized what I was still capable of and when I decided to make a comeback 2 years ago, that fire in me has not died, you know. So, yeah, I'm still here. I'm still here with that fire. I mean, the journey looks tough. The comeback looks harder than I thought, but I never give up.
What is that feeling of running? Like if you had to put it in words, what is it that charges you about it?
I don't know. I really don't know. It's a kind of a madness I have never tried to question myself about. Very young, I knew that I was capable of being international. I knew I had a gut feeling. My gut is very strong. My intuitive powers, my intuitive understanding of things, my intuitive acceptance of things around and, you know, taking it in is very strong, is very powerful. And that's why I don't really listen to people. Because I have my own inner voice. Everybody has that. But how you tap into that inner voice and how it helps you move forward is really important. And I think my inner voice has been my best friend for years. So when I got this kind of intuitive feeling that I was capable of being an international level athlete, at that time, the only word that came to my head was the Olympics. I didn't know Asian Games, Commonwealth, World Championships. Those words came much later to my understanding. But I was just like, when I won my first national gold medal, I want to go to the Olympics. My father said, now you've worn the state colors. Now it would be nice to see you in the India colors. And that has been stuck in my head for a long time. I also know that it's my father's dream, considering that that man gave up his whole life for me, for my career. It's something I owe my parents back, you know. And, well, I feel like I'm not going to be an Olympian now. And I'm not negative about it anymore. I'm practical about the fact that the Olympics are not for me, which has taken me a lot of convincing, self-convincing to accept that I will not be an Olympian. But I always say that I became an Olympian in my head many years ago. So physically being present there, I don't think it makes much of a difference. I conquered life and I'm a champion in life. So I'm very proud of that. And I think my parents are proud of that because they reached a point where I just couldn't run anymore. Like I didn't have the physical ability to run for the kind of pain I was going through. My parents just said, how does it matter? You've achieved so much more than just being an athlete of or an Olympian. Look at your journey as fit girl. So don't be disheartened. And it was their confidence that made me a little more confident that I was still doing well besides being a sprinter.
Interesting. And you've always been associated with sprinting, right? Sprinting would be what distances that you would be talking about?
Well, typically when we were younger, I'd say in 2000 up until 2010, I can say that sprinting was typically 100, 200, 400, 800. Today you have people sprinting the 1500.
I mean,
it's a joke. Yeah, exactly. You just cannot imagine the kind of competition that has that is going on in the world right now. Science has gone ahead. Technology has improved people's performance. People's willpower has become stronger. Food is better. Training facilities are better. Training methods have improved from the time that Carl Lewis was training to now Usain Bolt, right? And of course, the new generation of athletes after Usain Bolt. It's amazing how sprints have 100, 200 has taken a whole new, you know.
Correct.
There should be a new name for 100, 200. It shouldn't even be called sprints anymore. It should be called something super sprints or something like that. I mean, the competition in the world is ridiculous. You know, we're talking about girls who are now, let's say 20, 30 girls in the world are running sub 11. That is huge. That's just huge. I mean, that is fast.
Correct. And like, how is it that the bodies have evolved for this? Because like you said, technology is one thing, right? But technology also creates this machine of a body. And sprinting is all about this machine that you're trying to create, right? So what was it like to train it for sprinting, train the body for sprinting as opposed to running or as opposed to any other discipline that you probably were exposed to?
I was firstly not exposed to any other discipline besides sprinting. I have had a one-track mind my whole life. And I think that's why I got that far ahead. I was never distracted by any other sport. I never looked anywhere else. I never had any relationships. I had very few friends. I didn't socialize because my whole focus was I want to be at the Olympics. And when you have that focus, you become that machine. And I was very happy being that machine because our training was very specific to 100, 200. Back then, when I was training with Sabio, a lot of sprinting training requires you to be quick, agile, fast, powerful, really strong. Because there are so many factors involved when you are just going to be competing in a race. For that time, it was for me 12 seconds. There's no time to think in that 12 seconds, right? On your marks, get set, out. Before you know, the race is over. So sprinting requires a very different kind of training. It's very individualistic also. Today, when we talk about sprints, we talk about 100, 200, 400, which according to me, 400 is also a discipline that requires to have some kind of endurance training in it. Because only if you have the endurance in your legs, can you sustain training for 400. Every discipline, as in every event, I won't say discipline here, every event has a different mileage. So if you are running an 800 meters, you may still think that, oh, I'm just going to run two laps. But a weekly mileage for an 800 meter runner is 12 to 15K. I think that's less. Maybe some of them won't like it if they hear this. It's maybe more. Okay.
Right.
It's probably more. It's probably more. And if I'm going to be running 400, my weekly mileage should easily be 10 kilometers. Easily, right? But it's divided. It's not like I go and run a full 10K. With that kind of endurance in my leg, which comes in off season, then I move on to my mid-season training, which is more speed endurance. So you're doing longer longer distances, so 500 meters, 600 meters. You're doing reps of 800 meters with a shorter distance. So you're building more lactic in your legs. That way you're also preparing your body to train for pre-season. Because when pre-season comes, you start doing workouts like 400, 450, 500, which is heavy lactic building into your legs. So if you have that base of endurance in your legs, you can carry through those workouts, you know. So it's programming is a very intelligent thing, at the same time, very interesting of how you program. I have been very fortunate to be associated with some of the top coaches in the world. They may not all have been at the Olympic level, but when you get out of India, you will realize how much we lack as a sporting country. Fair enough, because we have not got that kind of exposure. Neither have our coaches got that kind of exposure. But it is on to the next generation to make sure that we start bringing in better training ideologies into our system, you know.
Correct.
So, yeah, I think I have in my head, I was actually pretty far ahead in my head. Every time I would go abroad and come to India and have to train here, I would still see these coaches and Indian athletes doing the same thing that we did as teenagers. I still see a lot of people on the track having little to no strength training in their body, no mobility, no understanding of what mobility is, you know, because typically when we were younger, it was all about ladder training, cone training, strength, like core training. Just some abs and back. I remember Savius's favorite word was like, you finish your training. Come on, get your max out. Abs and back training. It was abs and back. So basically you do crunches, you do some planks, you do some back extension and we do some partner stretching. Game over. Okay. But the good thing I liked about that was that it was a disciplined thing after every single workout.
Yeah.
That's what I really liked about Savius. But yes, we have a lot to do. We have a lot of young athletes to educate. And I know that I'm going to be an educator in that space. I may not be a qualified coach or a qualified trainer, but I think my experience over years speaks for itself of how much better I understand the game of running or the game of biomechanics, much better than these qualified coaches. But then again, you don't argue with them because in our country, it's a very big ego thing, you know.
Correct. Absolutely.
You're a white girl wearing tiny shorts and a crop top telling us what to do. You don't know what you're talking about. That's all right with me. I'm not going to argue. I will educate the people who want to be educated and who want to go through the right way. So I still encounter a lot of coaches like that, like where I am right now, very backward. Still, so many of them, very backward.
And you've been doing sprinting at a professional level, right? At a national level, talking about international. Now, when people are listening to this and thinking about sprinting and saying that, should I be doing sprinting, right? How should people incorporate sprinting into their daily life or into their exercise routine? They don't necessarily have athletic or want to become an athlete, but they want to
just run.
Just run. And we know about endurance training in terms of running, right? 10K, 15K, 25K, all of those. But where does sprinting fit into it?
It depends on how somebody is programming their training. Even a 10K athlete has to sprint.
Okay.
Right? Because, of course, I always talk about an international standard of training. That's how I think. When you see a lot of 10K runners or 5K runners doing reps of 200 meters, 300 meters, 400 meters, you wonder why they want to sprint when they're just going to, they're endurance athletes, right? But like I said, the world is progressing. Science has progressed. Technology has progressed. 10Ks are also getting fast. I mean, what are people running 10Ks? And women are running 10Ks in 32 minutes. So can you imagine how much speed they must be having in them over distance? So firstly, everyone can run, everyone can sprint. Like I always say, everyone can run, everyone can sprint. It's just that when you start sprinting from a younger age, supposing today if I make Deanne sprint, she will naturally go on the balls of her feet. Because naturally, when your body is young, it's very mobile. There are a lot of children who also have a lot of stiffness around their joints. Not all children are mobile. There are a few odd children who will not have that kind of flexibility and mobility. But the most children that I have encountered have very agile bodies. And because there is a lot of good mobility in their body, their ankles move very freely like that. You know, the ball of the foot lands on the ground first versus the heel. What happens as you grow older is because of the certain lifestyle also that we lead, our bodies lose that mobility, our joints lose that mobility, and then we start getting stiffer, our muscles get stiffer. So what is the most natural instinct when your body is stiff and tight? Your heel will land first to the
foot. Okay.
Right? That's why a lot of adults find it difficult to transition to running to the ball of the foot or running from midfoot to ball of the foot. There was a book that came out, Born to Run. Right? I haven't read that book, but I know the gist of that book. And I can tell you that the reason why, no matter how old they're, no matter how old or young they were, they would still be able to sprint faster than anyone because of the kind of lifestyle they led. They didn't sit on chairs. They didn't sit on easy chairs. They didn't sit on these gaming chairs. They didn't sit on couches.
Correct.
Either they sat cross-legged or they just sat on the floor.
Right? These are the tribal populations.
Yes, yes. And even today, if you go to villages, you'll see the kind of mobility that a lot of young children have. That's because in their homes, they probably just have one khatmal. Where two people sleep on top, the rest of the family sleeps on the floor. But when they eat their food, they're sitting cross-legged on the floor. So what happens when your joints are constantly mobile in the most natural form? You never lose that agility of your body. And the reason why people find it difficult to sprint today, especially the adult population like our age or say people in their 20s who have never sprinted as children, is because they've lost the mobility of their joints. And that's why I stress a lot on mobility training. I don't force people to sprint. Sprinting comes with a whole different understanding. But the good news is that people are at least running.
Correct.
And that makes me really happy. I mean, I wish that they would be more happier when they're running rather than thinking about what to wear, how much to wear, what to eat, what to post. You know, like if they let go of that stress, I think people will be so much happier running.
And you did endurance running for a bit as well.
What a mistake.
Why?
No, I'm kidding. Huh. I'm joking.
Like every single person listening to this who's
is an endurance
marathon,
just
fainted.
They don't like me anyway. They don't like me anyway. Most distance runners don't like me because I don't talk very highly about endurance
distance running.
But the truth is, historically and genetically, Indians are designed to run distance. We're not designed to be sprinters.
Describe that a little bit. Like, what is the difference in the body type? Is it a muscle fiber thing? Is it a bone thing?
I think it is. It has a lot to do with the famine that had hit India. Talk about probably centuries ago. And genetically, we are not strong people. Genetically. The Africans are genetically strong because they were slaves, right? So over centuries, their blood group, their genes, everything has become stronger and stronger because they were constantly working. I'm not very sure about what sets Indians apart from the Africans, but I had a very interesting conversation with Dr. Rajat when I was contemplating that should I get back to sprinting. This was many years ago. And he said, you know, it would be nice to tap into the distance space and see what you're capable of doing. And I was hell-bent against it. And he said, Aisha, Indians are designed to be distance runners. I may not have the right scientific knowledge behind it, but over those years, I observed a lot of people. I observed also a lot of sprinters in India who do run really well, including people like Hima Das, Duti Chand, Puamma. And we've had a great run with sprinters in the past, but we haven't really cracked it for a reason. You know, either people are taking steroids and pushing those boundaries to run faster. Or they're doing other means of things that are pushing them to run faster. But why do we not even have one sprinter coming in the top 10 at the Olympics, right? So I'm sure there's science behind that. And I know that Dr. Rajat is way more knowledgeable than me or anyone when it comes to this theory. But it does make sense to me. And I know that many a times I'm also fighting this, that I just want to be a sprinter. I just want to be a sprinter. But I hate him when he says that I might be a better distance runner. He's going to hear this podcast for sure. And then he's coming for me. The thunder.
I'm going to make you a distance runner. Come what
may. Which is funny because as we speak and... Because with my current situation of disc injury, I have been contemplating of running a distance race in the near future. Because what happens with me is that if I don't have a goal to wake up to every single day, I feel like it's a waste of my life. You know, I'm not like, I always say I'm not like regular people because I'm not a regular person. I'm very unique in my own way. And I remember Gavin saying, you were born to be different and make sure you hold that uniqueness hold it really strong in your heart. And I know why he said that, because if I was like everybody else, I would not be where I am today, you know, and I'm not where I am today because I do fantastic things on the media. I know I do very normal things on the media. I don't think I do anything exceptional. I mean, you know that there are women who are doing more exceptional. I am far from honestly being called fit girl, but this is something that you can't break for me. And I think that's what sets me apart from the rest of the people, because I don't complain. I'm not lazy. I never have an excuse for anything. And I'm always making effort. And many people don't have that. Very few people have that. I know a couple of people like me, I can say, 1, 2, 3, 4 women sitting next to me are like me. But the larger population of this world is not like that. And we need to make more like that. We need more women and men to just be super confident about themselves and just like go out there. And because I believe every single human being is born with a certain quality. It's just how they want to go out and achieve it. You know, the laziest of lazy people are the smartest sitting on their couches. And the smartest of smart peoples are out there just conquering the world. You know? And they may not be the very smart ones, but they know how to get out there because of their willpower, their determination. I think that's what really sets me apart from the rest of the crowd. But coming back to distance running, I needed a goal.
Distance running, I love what you were saying right now about the mentality and the mental fortitude, because that is something that is absolutely essential, especially as an
athlete. My mentality with endurance running is pathetic. My mentality is, I think that's just personally, I dislike running. I just find no joy in running. Like I want.
Correct.
See that? That's and how get my long foot should land. Like 100 meters, done. End of story. Go home. Workout's over. Race is over. You're not sitting and running for 2-3 hours. Looking at the scenery. I've done all of that. I've done all of that. And I know I'm going to be doing it again. I mean, I people will say, oh, she sounds like such a hypocrite. She hates it, but she still goes and does it. But that's because I don't have another goal right now to look ahead to. And this was the single goal that came to me. And I was like, there's not going to be another race this year. So might as well go for something. Just go and have fun, I told myself. Because thankfully, there's no timing to it. So even if I run that race in 5 hours, 6 hours, it's still okay. But the thing is that it has started waking me up every day because everybody is going through a tough time in this lockdown. Everybody is going through a phase which is, and I'm also one of those who can completely lose my motivation. I'm no different. But it's because of that drive that I've always had, right? It was the Olympic drive. That would wake me up every day. But right now I don't have that drive. So what's next? You know, with me, it's always about what's next. Well, A to Z, I have everything ready. I'm not the one to sit and say, oh, I don't have this. What should I do next? No, next, move on. This won't work. Parallel, Project Fit Girl. Start working on the next generation. Build up the next generation. There's no time to waste. People who waste time every day waking up saying, oh, I'm so bored, another day in lockdown. Buddy, get a grip of your life. There's a lot to do in this world. A lot. You know, besides making money, name, fame, there is a lot to do in this world. And people should take this in a positive way that even if you feel like you're sitting at home, wasted, please do something. There is so much to do. Learn a new skill. Find a new hobby. I know that everybody is done with reading, writing, and watching TV. There are many other things you can do. You can study plants, you can study animals, geography. How many places in the world do you know? Where do they exist? You know what I mean? There is just so much to do. And time is so short. You've got to value your time. Your life is really short. Do as much as you can. Like if we were not in a lockdown right now, I would be always encouraging people travel. Travel as much as you can because you were born to see the world. The world was created for us to see. Not for us to sit in our homes, not for us to just sit with our family and be like, oh, I have to look after my parents, I have to look after my children, etc., etc. No, get out there and live your life the way you're supposed to. You're supposed to see the world. But since you can't do that right now, find another medium to see the world. You know, it's a very beautiful place out there. And maybe that can motivate people. That can get them up every morning to say, I have this to look forward to today. You know, today I'm going to learn something from Animal Planet. Today I'm going to watch something by David Attenborough and I'm going to learn something new about what's going on in Alaska or in Finland. Nobody knows the Northern Lights are disappearing. Now, these are important things you should be knowing, right? So just everyone can do something. It's just in the head how much you want to do it.
And was this something that was taught to you? Was this something that was inborn?
This?
The way that you think about motivation, the way that you think about all these things?
I'm just very driven. I'm very driven. And I've never wanted to be at the top. I never thought that I would be Fit Girl. I never thought that the success or fame would come because this was not even on the charts. The only thing on the chart was to be an Olympian. That is it. And I worked diligently towards that goal. I hope the universe was happy with that. And then it gave me Fit Girl. But I have never been obsessed with wanting to be somewhere. I've just wanted to keep doing things to better myself. Because as a young girl, everyone told me I was useless. I was slow. I was quite slow. My understanding and retention power with the whole education system was just poor. Everyone said I would not make it. And it at a very young age, I kind of went into a very, I won't say depressive phase, but I was trying to understand that why am I being told off all the time, you know? Surely I have a gift that is different. And that gift was running, you know? When I crossed that finish line, it was exhilarating. That feeling I cannot describe. And that feeling is so fresh in my head. You saw a photograph of me the other day on my Instagram, me in my red. It was a school photograph.
Okay.
I was in my Nehru House clothes, red clothes, with Mrs. Dungaji giving me a trophy and Savio standing there. That was my fifth grade photograph. Okay, getting the fastest girl trophy from Savio, sir. It's a very fresh thing in my head. From there on, I knew I was capable of something.
Right.
And then I was unstoppable. I think I'm an unstoppable force. If somebody says it or not, I am. And I don't think, I think the only force that can really tell me to stop or slow down is the universe. It has its ways of slowing me down. And I feel like my injuries are one of them. That's a message that keeps coming from the universe, which keeps telling me slow down, slow down, slow down. And I'm just like, no. So when I defied it too much, it told me, now you're going to stop. Now you don't defy me. Yeah, I always say this a lot, you know, you don't defy nature in any way. So yeah, it's showing me its way. I have to respect it now.
Correct. What are two things that you would tell people to get that athletic or that athlete mentality into their life? You know, we were talking about motivation.
You can't.
We were talking about driven.
You can't.
Really? Can't be taught.
Let me try teaching it to you. And then tell me if you love running.
But sprinting, I'm game with you on. The other one, I can't bear to think that I'm going to waste 2 hours of my life not knowing where I'm going and coming back again.
But there, like, you go. Now we're friends.
Totally. I'm telling you, sprinting 100%. Run from here to there, lovely. Puke at the other end after trying to give it your all, lovely. But just keep going. Tapak, 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 tapak.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
And that's why we had horses, which is also a strange
Or cycles. Or motorbikes. No.
Love it. Oh God.
Motivation is a very inborn thing. You are either intuitively wanting to get somewhere. That's why you make an effort to do it. That's why your motivation comes, or you're forced to do it. And then you hate it. So when someone says, I mean, I've had many children in my career of coaching who came to my class just because their parents sent them for an athletics class. But by the end of it, they loved it. When I left coaching with children last year, I could tell that these kids were never going to give up on running. They may not become athletes, but I knew that they would not give up on running because I gave them the joy. I gave them that passion, just how Sabyosa gave it to me. You know, the only thing I keep telling everyone is enjoy it, have fun. Don't think too hard about it because there's no rocket science with running. Unless and until you want to get to the Olympics, you want to train for that level, there's science involved. But if not, just go out there and have fun. And if somebody intuitively says, yeah, I want to get better, I want to run fast, I'm going to make effort. That's where your motivation is driven from, right? Like you're driven to sprint. I'm not driven to do endurance training, but then I'm also very psychotic like that. If I make up my mind that I'm going to run 42 kilometers, I'm going to run 42 kilometers. Even if that means I will crawl it. Because I don't believe that everything has to go the same way that everyone does it. If I put my mind to something that I'm going to do, I will do it. So even if that means I hate it, but because I have already told myself that I'm going to do it, I will do it. I mean, there's no other way out. There never is another way out for me. My tunnel is one way.
Very hardcore.
I'm very hard on myself. I'm extremely, I have a lot of expectations from my own self because I know how capable I am. I have just not been able to produce the results, and which is why a lot of people say, oh, bahut bolti hai, lekin Olympics tak to gayi nahi. But nobody knows the suffering that I have gone through, through my injuries. Nobody knows that I didn't have the right guidance. Nobody knows I didn't have the financial backing. Everybody is just easy to point fingers and say, oh, she's a big talker, but she's not made it. Just last night, I was talking to my friend Kunal, and he said, we both have this discussion. He was, he's a former cricketer. We both had the exact same conversation that if both of us had the right knowledge, which we have now as coaches, the right knowledge on strength training, technical strength training, mobility, core. If we had that when we were in our 20s, we would have both played for India by now, you know, but we didn't have that then. And you can't sit and cry about it now because lost time never comes back. Right.
You can only look ahead.
You can just look ahead. You can look ahead and make sure that the next generation that comes in doesn't make the same mistakes. You know, and you give them what you have learned, because at the end, sport and fitness and any kind of anything to do with sports and fitness is about education. It's about sharing that knowledge. You can't just hoard your knowledge and keep it to yourself. Then you're not a good coach. Coaching is about giving.
You know? Correct.
It is like parenting.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is like parenting.
And you create very, very deep bonds with your coach. And that is all, right? And it's not just on the track. It's away from the track. It's all the mental things, the emotional
Absolutely.
Things, all of that.
It's always sports and life. Always. What you do in your sport, you will do in life. And what you do in your life, you will do in sport. Be it your diligence, discipline, dedication, consistency, determination. Either you're too enthusiastic or you're lazy. Everything. I mean, that's what I love about sport. It makes you into such a fine human being. Right?
Beautiful. Beautiful. I think this is a perfect spot to end this particular podcast because I love the way that you spoke about sports and the aspects of that and how you can get that into life. Yeah. Thank you so much, Aisha. Aisha, how can people get in touch with you? What is the best way of connecting with you, taking a discussion forward?
Well, I can give my phone number if you like, but this isn't a great platform for that. But they can.
You know how many people are like, shit, abhi te to pen kahan hai? Where is the paper?
I could say it really fast and people will miss out on it. But no, I am available on Instagram, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, all of that. I go by the name fitgirl.india. And yes, I'm always happy to help people. I believe it is my duty and my job to guide people the right way. So anybody who has any questions, also people can buy my book, Run. I've got, you know, when I was writing the book, Run, I wasn't sure if people would accept that there is a certain way to run because everyone says, oh, what's there to learn in running? You can all run. No, but there is a stance. There is a way to run. There is a posture. There is this grace that comes with running. And you have to learn it because it's so beautiful, you know? And when people gave me feedback on that book, I was amazed at how many people had run a 10K following the program from that book.
Wow.
And giving me really good feedback. So to the listeners here, if you're a complete novice, and even if you don't like running, just give it a shot. Read the book. It will definitely guide you. It teaches you the alignment principles of the body. It teaches you the alignment principles of running. And it teaches you just how to enjoy it, most important. So it talks a bit about food also, which is great. People like that. People are going to buy this book because there's food involved in it. Everybody wants to have a diet plan, but nobody wants to have a good running program or a training program. So, yeah. But yes, Instagram, Facebook, wherever people. Instagram mainly, but also YouTube, Facebook.
Lovely. And what is your YouTube channel called? Again, fitgirl.india?
Everything is fitgirl.india.
Superb. Lovely. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yay. So start these habits and share with us your progress using the hashtag TheHabitCoach. If you like this podcast, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can listen to us on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. You can also follow us on social media. We are at IVM Podcasts on Twitter and Instagram. If you want to reach out to me, I am Ashtin Doc on Twitter and Instagram. You can find lots more information on my website, awesome180.com, or check out different content on my YouTube channel called AWESOME180. That's awesome180.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, Siet and Cred. We really appreciate the support. It is what makes this possible. So it was a fun week on Cyrus Says. We had guests like Dolly Singh, we had Guneet Monga, we had Kamya Jani of Curry Tales, and Cock and Bull as we always did. Do check it out. I think you'll really, really enjoy that. On Paisa Vaisa, we crossed 300 episodes and Anupam was joined by Akhil Handa, the digital head of Bank of Baroda. All things policy discussed topics like the 100 years of China's Communist Party, the Facebook versus the Government of India case, and the evolution of Indian science. On The Wire Talk, Siddharth Bhatia was joined by Gautam Bhatia to discuss the Central Vista project and why it's attracting so much flack. Sadaf and Archit are back on the Naan Curry podcast, and this time they raise the temperatures as they discuss the beloved spice mirchi. On The Millennial Athlete, this week Tanvi and Shlok speak to Sarita Chauri, a visually impaired judoist. And finally, I want to ask you all to give a listen to the Triangle Offense. Anybody who has heard me talk on a podcast knows I can't shut up about basketball, and these guys know more about it than I do. So if you enjoy basketball, do check this out. Nishant and Monish do an excellent job with this show. I was one of their guests a few months ago, which is how I met them and tried to convince them to come onto the network, and they're finally here. So definitely do check this out. Show's available on all major podcasting platforms, but they also have a daily YouTube episode, which is available on the IVM Podcast channel. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Whether you're an established sports person or a budding one, or simply a sports enthusiast, join us, Tanvi and Shlok.
We are two passionate pro badminton players talking policy, mindset and everything sport.
So tune in to The Millennial Athlete every Monday.
Only on the IVM Podcast Network.
Trust us, it's gonna be lit.